All right, so for new products, we're doing the products from the product page, and for the special.
I love that.
New one.
Okay, so first up, let's go to the updated product, which is the 2.13. So this is updated. The chipset changed and the connector is longer. It was like a shorter connector, now it's a longer one, but it's still a flexible 2.12 by 104 flexible display. What's nice is this one can do grayscale. So if you click on the grayscale,
I'm gonna get all
images, monochrome.
Yeah. Show off our nice product pages.
It's cool. I mean, photographers are really killing it. Yeah. It can do 4-layer grayscale. So it's like black, dark gray, light gray, you know, and white background. Using the ILI 0373 chipset. So basically we used to have this old version. Now we have this version. It's not drop-in compatible completely because the connector is longer and you do need to have a new firmware compilation because it's a different chipset. But I think it's actually a better display at the same price. So that's an updated product.
Yeah. And we're making e-ink so easy and we're going to get to all of it. Don't worry.
Yeah.
It's a good time to start doing e-ink projects.
Okay.
Alrighty.
Speaking of e-ink, we also have another big display, and then maybe I'll hold it up so people can see how big it is. This is a very chunky display. So this is a raw e-ink. So you can go to the overhead, or
hold it up here.
Okay. You can see how big it is. This is a big display, 5.83 inches, 640-ish by 480. So it's kind of VGA resolution, monochrome. It doesn't do. This doesn't do grayscale. But it has, the number of pixels and the bit resolution make it a really beautiful display. We got drivers in Arduino, drivers in Python and CircuitPython for this coming in a day or two. Fun to drive. This is just the raw display. Eventually, I'm going to have like something that has this on it. But for now, you'll need a driver. Like we have the Thinking Friend, which uses the standard 24-pin connector, or you can use the Thinking Feather. We also have a bonnet we're designing for Raspberry Pi. But it does use the standard 24-pin connector. So you just get this raw display, plug it into whatever, and then just make sure you have firmware for the driver chip, and you've got this like beautiful display. So we're going to be doing some cool e-ink projects with these.
Okay, maybe we'll see what's on the product page for this too. On the product page, you can check this out.
So you got the update image.
Yeah, we got the updated images and the videos and everything. But the other thing we have is you can select all the different ones over to the right inside there.
Got a lot of different displays, and we're going to get tri-color versions of this and the other ones as well.
Yeah.
Cool ink. Okay.
And then next up,
let's skip this one because this is a star. Yeah. So we got the Snap-on, some Snap-on
coaches. Yeah, these are great.
So this is the driver for our LED nudes. Any LED. It's a great LED driver because it's a constant current LED booster, which I think is great for, in my opinion, our filaments and nudes. But anytime you want to have anything drive LEDs at, 20, 50, 100, 100, up to 250 milliamp, sorry, up to 300 something milliamps from a 3 to 5 volt input. But you probably want to, for people using this for props and stuff, we want to make a little board that is just a protector to make it easy for you to attach this to your wearable project. So this is a little snap together case designed by Noe and Pedro that we just got 3D printed and in the shop. This is a JST puller. So this is like somebody pointed this out that we have. So our batteries come with genuine JST, but there's sometimes people buy batteries from other suppliers and they don't use genuine JST and they get a little stuck in the plug. You have to like loosen them up a little bit the first two times. This will make sure you don't yank by the wires, which you shouldn't do. You yank by the connector. So it kind of fits over the little flare of the JST connector and lets you pull it out. Again, a little low-cost 3D printed thing. We have files also for these if you want to 3D print them yourself. We basically have it as a convenience for others. And then the star of the show, I don't know if you want to go to the...
Yeah.
It's up. There you go.
Oh, yeah.
Next time, we'll make sure it's like the... top thing is the MLX 9632, requested by the Adafruit IoT, but also something that I've wanted to have for a while. This is a single temperature remote IR thermal sensor. So we have thermal cameras and we have temperature sensors that you have to touch, like it has to touch the thing for it to tell the temperature. This is something that can tell the temperature of a remote object by reading the infrared light that's emitted off, like that's bounced off of it. And it's very similar. Like we used to have like the TMP007 or the TMP06. We have little sensors like the MLX 90, I think 614, but those have, you have to have like, you have to do on a breadboard and there's like wires. This is a systemic QT. You plug and play it into anything. It has level shifting and regulation built in. We have Arduino code for it. We're going to have the Python circuit Python code real soon as we do the port. And it's really a nice sensor because again, it can do both remote and local sensing. This is the medical version. We'll probably have the other standard version as well. This one is, it can measure negative 20 to 100 degrees C of the remote object, but it's really tuned for remote detection of like human body temperature. It's meant for like, you know, thermal temperatures for like, you know, when you point it at your forehead or in your ear and it measures the temperature. That's the kind of sensor that it's designed for. So it has much better accuracy and precision when measuring, and they say like livestock or people, but people can also be livestock and livestock can be people. So it's good for that, but it can also measure the extended range of 0 to 100. It's just really optimized for that, you know, 90 to 110 degree range where you're going to get like 0.2 degree centigrade accuracy. So I have a little demo. And
I'm still thinking about this livestock thing you said. I'm kind of reeling from it. I'll be okay. Just 1 second.
Woo. Okay. So I've just got the sensor connected up here. And right now it's just measuring like the, you know, it's just like the ambient is room temperature. If I put my hand over it, I'm not touching it. Here, I'll do it over here. I'm not touching it. It's just pointing at my hand, but it's detecting the warmth emitted from my hand. If I steal your can of soda and I point at the can of soda, you'll see it's cooler than room temperature because it was in the fridge, you know, an hour ago. It's very, very fast. It seems very, very accurate. So far, this is the only sensor we could find that is at this cost level, pick and placeable, and can do remote sensing. So we're going to do, there's some projects we want to do with measuring temperature of plants. And it's very hard to attach a sensor to a plant. So, because they're like flexible and they're like, the leaves are delicate. So this is a great option for doing that. But anytime you don't want to touch a thing for safety or, you know, like medical reasons, you don't want to actually like touch the person on the livestock. This is a great sensor. But one of the only ones, I think that we covered this on INPI or the Great Search, we were like looking for the sensor.
Yeah.
And now we're bringing it for it. It's in the store.
I don't want to touch anything because of medical reasons.
Just moo. Yeah.
Okay. And
that's
special thanks to our team, our customers, everyone in the open source community, everyone who makes this thing go. The star of the show was this product, but y'all are the star of the show.
You are the stars.
All righty. That's new products of the week.